Okay, everybody. This exercise is looking at the culinary design process, and we spoke quite a lot about this during the workshop when we were down here in Dunedin. Purpose of this exercise is to get you to look at a piece of work that you have created, some sort of menu or product range, for instance. And it doesn't need to be overly complicated, but take just a significant piece of work that is your work. And we're going to apply this design model to it and see and look at the ways that you design and how you design and what things are important to you when you create new dishes and new menus and the like. And during the workshop, I used the example of Eggs Benedict is a really good example of how we could look at this design model. So here is the design model that we sort of spoke about, and in the middle of that is I've put a picture of Eggs Benedict. So if we were to consider when we design food, if we think about Eggs Benedict, the first thing that I would say is Eggs Benedict classically is a piece of toast with ox tongue on it, poached eggs, hollandaise sauce, and truffle. Now, if we look at this section down here, which is society, we now know that we probably wouldn't do a traditional Eggs Benedict because society has changed from when the Eggs Benedict was created. I'm not even sure who even created it, but things have moved on. So if you were putting Eggs Benedict on the menu, if you were thinking about, okay, well, what's happening in society at the moment? So you might be thinking about things like, well, if local food is really important in my menu design, would I see if the ham or bacon, depending on what you use, was a local ingredient? Would you be considering things like, well, society demands that gluten-free is an option, so would you be looking at having maybe gluten-free muffin bases available or bread maybe available to them? Would you be thinking about, when you design your menu, would you be thinking about things like society and the fact that nutrition and healthy op food options are important now. So, would you serve the sauce over the eggs or would you serve it to the side? I mean, depending on the kind of market that you're designing the food for, it would be appropriate sometimes to serve the hollandaise on the side. I guess also, if you're thinking about society and what was happening at the moment, you might be thinking about things, for instance, like, what is the economic situation? How much can we charge for Eggs Benedict at the moment because there's a recession on and disposable income is reduced and it's a relatively inexpensive product to produce. So how much would we charge for it? You might also be thinking, well, with my Eggs Benedict, because of the economic situation, am I going to not serve a hash brown with it like I normally did, or am I going to take that off the menu because it's too expensive and people can pay for that extra and give them the option if they want to pay for it? So just thinking about at the moment with society, what's happening. And also, I would probably suspect if we were looking at Eggs Benedict, we'd be saying, well, at the moment, there's a real move towards free range. And so would you consider that as a possibility, or do you consider that when you design food? If we move up to, that was the society part, if we move up here to this bit here called the commercial considerations, these are the things that we think about when designing, and often these are at the forefront of what we think about. So, what, for instance, what are my kitchen budgets? How much can I charge for it? If my kitchen budgets are quite tight, maybe I can't afford to offer free-range eggs or offer local ham. Maybe I have to just offer the most affordable product that is available. Thinking about things like suppliers, well, even if I did want to offer free range, is it a possibility? Are there actually enough suppliers out there who can supply me with free range ham, for instance? And also thinking about the business itself, what is the business? What is the target market of this business? Yes, if I was probably in a more affluent part of town where we have people who have a higher disposable income, they may be able to afford to pay, maybe $3, $4 more for a portion of Eggs Benedict because of their disposable income. But if you were in a part of town and your target market was that, money was tight and they couldn't necessarily afford. Price was a big part of the decision of where they shop, where they dine. So would that be a factor? Also thinking about the actual staffing levels, do I actually have staff that actually can make hollandaise? Is it, or do, would I have to use a commercial product using, say, one of the a brand that comes to mind is the Cato, sort of hollandaise in a packet sort of stuff, which is really in a mayonnaise-based product. But at the end of the day, if you're only serving, say, two portions of Eggs Benedict a day, I mean, in your business, that might be appropriate to start thinking about that. Also, if you're really into health-conscious decisions, you might be starting to think about offering an oil-based hollandaise as to a butter-based hollandaise because it, for society, it's actually a healthier option. That would be your decision. So those are all kinds of commercial considerations that we think about when we design our menus. The next one that I want to have a look at is up here, culinary technologies and practices. So when you're designing your menu and your dishes, you'd be thinking about, okay, what kind of technology or equipment do I have or could I use? And what practices or processes are appropriate? So what's currently happening in the world with cookery and the way that we present food and the techniques that we apply to food, and would it be appropriate to us? So if we were to take the Eggs Benedict scenario again, we might say, well, what technology, what equipment do I use or could I use? So depending on your establishment or how you or where you work, it could be as simple as, well, realistically, we only have the capacity to use pots and water for poaching our eggs. We've got a grill or a toaster for our buns. But I guess in terms of technology, you could look at the hollandaise and say, well, maybe I could make it in over a bain-marie, or maybe because of the number of staff that we have, we just make it all in a blender where we put egg yolks and oil, and then we add in hot butter and we make it that way. Or maybe our establishment is such that we can use a thermomix so that we can actually heat up the sauvignon in the thermomix and then slowly add on the butter to the thermomix. So that's technology that you could use in every business that you work in or establishment. You make the choice dependent. In the same way, you might say, well, maybe I could cook the eggs in a sous vide machine. I mean, that's if that's appropriate for how you for your business, and that's something that you would consider. But there'll be reasons why you're doing it. It's dependent upon the market that you're cooking for. So these are all kinds of things that we can think about. The next thing that I want to have a look at is this creative inspiration process. And I'm going to give you an example. Eggs Benedict doesn't really require any creative inspiration because it is a classic dish that has been around for a very long time. It's very familiar to everybody. But often when we're looking for new creative ways to come up with dishes, we need to look at, well, we often look at classic dishes and use them as the basis of creating new dishes. So if we take Eggs Benedict as a classic dish, and we're thinking to ourselves, right, I want to use that as the inspiration for a new dish. How would that be? So here's an example that I've just quickly come up with. So let's take the idea of this Mexican breakfast. So here it has poached eggs, it has some grilled bacon, served on an avocado and bell pepper corn cake with a lime and coriander hollandaise. So if I hadn't said anything about the fact that it's based on the Eggs Benedict, I probably wouldn't know. But if we look at that dish, we can see, it has eggs, which we recognize as being from Eggs Benedict. Instead of ham, we've got grilled bacon. The muffin has been replaced by something that's got a bit of a Mexican feel to it, so some avocado and bell pepper corn cake. And then the hollandaise has been flavored with lime and coriander to give it a kind of a Mexican feel to it. So when you look at your menu, it's really important that you look at each of the dishes in your menu and think to yourself, Where did I get the idea for these dishes? Where did they come from? And if you have a look on the Creative Inspiration PowerPoint that's on Moodle, that will give you some really good examples of how we create new dishes. And we cover this a little bit on the workshop, the ways in which we get inspired to create. Knowing sort of that as chefs, we mainly get inspired by looking at other cultures. We might also get inspired by visiting and eating out at other restaurants or visiting other producers, and also through reworking really classical, successful dishes that have worked in the past for us and reworking them in a new way. So an example of that may be you've created a dish in the past that was duck breast with star anise, and then you take that classic combination that you've worked with in the past and you rework it, and now it becomes duck with licorice, and it's similar characteristics, but it's just been reworked ever so slightly. And that leaves us with the last area that we want to look at, which is the sensory evaluation. So when you're designing your food and designing your dishes, what things are important to you when you design in terms of the food's taste, the smell, how it's presented? You know, are you a very contemporary person who, you know, and probably in today's presentation would be very linear in how you plate your food? Or are you somebody who's quite casual and quite rustic and uses lots of sort of nature on your plate and looking, yeah, quite rustic? And in terms of textures, you know, what textures are important to you when you design food? And so, if we were to look at, say, this Mexican breakfast, as a good example of it, we might look at this and say, well, we can see that we've got the sweetness of the bacon coming through, we've got a little bit of acidity from the hollandaise happening there, we've got nice textures in terms of we've got a corn cake, we've got the sort of texture of the bacon and the eggs. And so we've got sort of a salty factor coming in also from the grilled bacon. So, you know, what factors, what sensory things are really important to you when you design food, and what were you thinking about when you were writing this menu that you choose to have a look at? And how do you know that it's going to be successful? Do you get other members of your kitchen staff to taste it and give you feedback? Do you ask for the opinions of your front of house staff, or do you ask to get customer feedback? You just put it on as a special and then you know, get feedback and make changes before you put it on the menu, or do you put it on the menu and get initial feedback and quickly adjust it and make changes to it that way? So how do you know that the food that you are designing is actually is acceptable and what customers want, and in some ways is what we call a balanced dish? So these are some of the things that we think about when we design food, but they are certainly not limited to. There are many, many things that we think about when we design food, and I'd also like you to put them down and list them when you're thinking about how you design food and what's important to you. So I hope this is an enjoyable exercise. From this exercise, it's going to reveal quite a lot about you, and that's what Paul needs in terms of bringing together some of your presentations. And the other thing that I'd just like to say about the exercise is that while I'm saying, tell me what you were thinking at the time, it is more than likely that you probably weren't thinking in this way, but I want you to go back and revisit this menu and look at this menu through this model and think about, well, if I did this menu 5 years ago, you know, what was happening in society 5 years ago that probably influenced what I was doing and how I was thinking at the time? Because for many of you, this will be something that will be subconscious, and part of this process that you're going through is to make subconscious thoughts instinctual and conscious, so that you are completely aware of the decisions that you're making and why you are making them. Okay, so have fun with that, and we look forward to seeing your work when it's completed.